This is exciting that we're gonna start a series of summer workshops to really prepare you transition remote to online or transition remote to flip, transition remote to hybrid. And there's a series of workshops we're gonna offer. And then the workshop will be hosted every week from now on, from Monday and Thursday, from 1 o'clock to 2:30. Why there's a 90 minutes? Because we thought, you know, sometimes there's a lot of content to go over and then faculty could get Zoom fatigue. So what we want to do is we want to do more interaction. We want to invite more faculty speaker coming in to showcase their experience. And our training will be brief. So it will not be like a full 1 hour training, but we're gonna do a lot of these kind of discussions. And then, you know, the extra 30 minutes, we're gonna do breakouts. So everybody may have different levels of understanding or have specific questions. So we'll have different breakouts to fulfill that kind of need. So we have been giving a lot of thought about how we can better support UCF faculty returning back to campus in fall. I know this is such a stressful subject. Everybody's like, what are we going to do? Nobody knows. So we put together four different themes to be included in the summer workshop series. So the first thing, each thing will cover like a 2 weeks with 4 workshops. So the first thing is transition remote to online instructional video production, because a lot of faculty really want to find out, what am I gonna do with all the videos I've done last year? I don't want to throw it away, but it's not perfect. So what do I do? So we're gonna share with you what you can repurpose them. And then after that, we're gonna talk a little bit of the course design for flip and hybrid modes of teaching, because you know, some of our students may still get stuck in foreign country, or they have some sort of family emergency, they just cannot be on campus. So you may have to deal with two groups. A majority will be on campus and a very small group of people may be still remotely. And then because of Delta variant, so who knows what's gonna happen. So you may want to be in the same room with 400 students. So that kind of force, you may have to decide to do some sort of hybrid. So everybody choose one day to come Monday and Friday, and you can break the class into 3 groups or something like that. Then it becomes so tricky, because how do I deliver my course with people coming out different times? So we decided we're gonna come up with a session. We will explore it together, how we're gonna design the course to fit in this kind of flip hybrid mode, so it will accommodate everybody. After that, we probably want to think about, since everybody's coming from different place, you know, some people remote, some people on campus, some people here and there. So it is very important to continue to engage our students no matter where they are. So we want to spend another 2 weeks to talk about how can we implement digital active learning using Canvas and external tools to connect everybody together as a whole, even though they are located in different places. So that's what we thought would be important to cover that. Finally, we know a lot of the faculty are really overwhelmed, and a lot of faculty decided to use summer to catch up their research. So we are going to do some sort of boot camp for those who just not gonna be able to plan ahead of the day. So we're gonna use the last 2 weeks of the summer to really talk about boot camp. We're gonna cover more topics that will be urgent, like how do you manage the first day of class, that kind of topic. So this is the whole theme of our series. But each of the topics, it will contain 4 workshops. So the first series is transition remote to online instructional video production. And you can see there are 4 different days, and these links will take you to the registration links. All right, I am very honored to introduce our presenters today. Natalie Hanlon is a video producer at DTEI. She has been helping many UCF faculty about video production related questions, especially during the pandemic. So today she's gonna share with you, how do you think about your existing video? Should you re-record or should you purpose. And Professor Sabrina Salenki is going to share with us her experience, how she record the videos to share with students and enhance their learning. So we're really honored to have a faculty presenter today to really share the experience. So before we begin, I am going to talk about the agenda. So really quickly, I would like to talk about what you need to consider before you begin and what option do you have in terms of these videos. And then Natalie is gonna share with you about how to use video editing strategy to repurpose existing videos. And Sabrina is gonna share about how do you make overview video to guide your students. And we'll have 10 minutes of Q&A and prep for breakout. And the 30 minutes, we're gonna do breakout sessions. So that will be today's session. So let me make sure my time, I still have some time, great. So before we begin, I just want to get a sense of what your experience has been. So I'm going to start, another poll now to kind of check with your experience and what you plan to do in fall. So why there's a new poll posting on your view. I am curious about what your plan's going to be. Are you going to teach in the classroom more like a traditional format or you're thinking about to do more flip kind of way so student will study the content before they come to class and you're gonna use a classroom to do like full interaction kind of thing, or you want to do hybrid. And there's two different online mode. I kind of use this term called synchronous online, which is that I'm going to meet with my student in Zoom in fall, or I'm going to record lecture videos and do it asynchronously. And these questions are multiple answers, so you can choose more than one. So you may want to do both, then you want to choose both. And obviously, I know there's a group of faculty still in this mode of trying to figure out what to do. So now we have about 13 people to participate in, so I'm going to end the poll now, and I'm gonna share. As you can see, this is really interesting because we have equal amount of faculty wanting to do each of the instruction. And that kind of reflect on why these workshops are really important, because it's almost like we need to cover everything. There's no one majority way, just because for the pandemic, we really have to accommodate that. So interesting result. So after we do this poll, I would like to also ask you to reflect. This is more like a reflective question. Before we think about recording a video, repurpose a video, you really want to get a good idea of why you want to have a video, you know? So let me know, have you ever done any of these things? So we kind of get an idea about what our faculty usually use video to fulfill, what kind of pedagogical instructional need. So let us know, have you, your prior experience, you know, what have you done before? So we kind of get an idea about what is the most popular purpose for faculty to create videos, and what, you know, how many people already have certain kind of experience, that kind of thing. So right now we have people who are still participating, and then we'll get a good idea about this group, you know, what your needs are. So now we have 16 faculty participated, so I'm gonna end the poll and I'll share the result with you. As you can see, most of the faculty have done live synchronous lectures through Zoom. That's a very good thing, because at least you already have a Zoom recording available in your Zoom portal. Making sure that you double check a lot of the recording you have done, let's say in March and April, may be expired soon. So you want to download it to your computer so you don't lose them. And then throughout these 2 weeks, Natalie's gonna show you how you can edit these videos and make it repurposed for your fall teaching, or you know, what would be good to re-record. Another popular way that people use video is really to search videos from the internet. I am so happy to see this is also a popular way for faculty to use video, because to be quite honest, there are a lot of quality videos already created available on the internet. Sometimes you may want to spend your effort. This is how I help faculty to manage stress and avoid burnout. Because if you think about, oh my God, I have to record every lectures and make it available online, that would take me so much time to record. But if somebody already did the work for you, what you really can do is using the existing video that you found from the internet, obviously quality video. And you will put your effort, instead of spending time record that video, you will spend your effort and think about learning experience. How can you design activities, assignments, questions after they watch that video? So you will focus on guiding their learning versus trying to create content. So I'm glad that our UCF faculty are so ahead of the game that that is a popular approach. And the second most popular way that people have done before is you actually pre-recorded some videos already. That is awesome, because that means you know how to do it. No matter you feel you still need to sharpen your skill or not, but you actually did that. So if you already have pre-recorded videos, that is just great. You're ahead of the game. And then this week, we're going to show you how to, you know, review them and edit them. And you know, equal amount of faculty, my God, so cool, you already edit your video using a computer software. This week, Natalie is gonna show you how to use a software called Adobe Premiere Rush that's available free to all UCM members, including faculty and students. So you will be able to learn some simple way to edit your video using the software. So just kind of letting you know, I'm glad that some of faculty already had this kind of experience. For those who had the experience, record the video using your phone or mobile device, or you have kind of used an ad hoc video using Canvas, you know, that is great, because you can download those video and figure out how you can edit it to repurpose them. So let me stop sharing here for a second. So those are the things, you know, I think it's important that we kind of think about before we start today's session. And now I'm just gonna start a really quick 2 minutes of reflection to ask you, what type of instructions or like a teaching strategies can be fulfilled by video? So that's a very similar way that we just talked about. So if you click on this link here, and Natalie's gonna put the link in the chat, you're gonna get a Google Doc here. So I am going to welcome everybody to just unmute your microphone and tell me, what do you want to use the video for your teaching? Or why do you want to create video? So you can answer, just type in your answer. That's wonderful. Julia started to do that. And or you can just talk and I'll type it for you. Or you can type in the chat and it will transfer it for you. So let's see what people are saying. So Michelle is saying to have a means by which student can view, better comprehend. That's awesome. So let's just give a few minutes and see how everybody's been thinking about ways to use these videos. Obviously, you're coming to this webinar because you want to do some videos for your teaching. And this is many ways of how people are going to use the videos. And this is also give us a very good information to prepare for Thursday's workshop. Because in our Thursday's workshop, we're going to talk about tips, tricks, and best practices of using, you know, instructional video, how to edit it. And then by knowing how you're going to use your videos, it's going to help us to kind of ship our presentation to fit your needs. So thank you very much. I am so, this is always an exciting activity that you just see all the participants start to sharing their thoughts on a document together. And by the way, this is also a very good kind of activities for you to do in your remote class. Like if you do your Zoom sessions or even in classroom, you know, people can just participate in this way. And one tip about using these kind of instructions is you want to make sure you want to share this document to anyone with the internet, on the internet can edit. So you will not avoid any troubleshooting people don't have access. And then you can always limit that right after the class, but during the class, you want to give them the opportunity to share. Okay, so let's kind of review some of the needs. Some people use the video to record teaching, but also share video functions for your performance ballet. Wonderful. You have used students pre-recorded short readings. Oh, that's awesome. That's a great activity that student can also record a video. You don't have to be the one always recorded, right? And some people that I also interview other scholars remotely to enrich the expertise. You know, this is awesome. Thank you. And another faculty say they want to use if which student can view a better comprehend the material. So it's more like enhance their learning experience. You know, it will target a wider audience. Good for timekeeping. That is really a good point because a lot of time the Zoom lecture is really stressful because there's always this kind of unexpected things happen and it ended up taking a lot of time. So if you can allocate some of the video for them to watch before, then that will help you to manage your time better. Good for different time zone. Wonderful. That is very important. To have students understand and absorb the material on their own pace. Yes, this is what we call mastery learning. So everybody will do it on their own pace, their own time, especially during the pandemic that people are very have a very different time availability. People are in different time zones. So if they can have more like self-paced kind of material to learn, that is really cool. And it's cool that you say in a hybrid class setting, that's absolutely right. So give student lecture slides as a PDF. Yes, that's important. Just like how we do this today, you know, I'll give you the PDF slides so they can actually watch the recording and follow the slides. To build content to flip portion. Yes, in that way, you can actually use your class time to do interactions. These are wonderful answers. I feel like you are all experts now. You have a very good mindset. I use video to view viewpoints that everybody remembers and prereq classes. Yes, for prepare the class. Use video to introduce a point before we workshop. Yes, wonderful. Use video to review common issues. That is also really good. You can always use an ad hoc video to talk about common questions that people miss or give feedback. Use video for students who miss class, great, because that happens a lot during the pandemic. Record my lectures either while teaching synchronously or in advance so that students can view them, watch them. Yeah, perfect. Deconstruct and I love this word deconstruct. So you actually break down your class into the smaller segment to have a discussion. That is really good. Review readings, emphasize key theory. So, you know, that's kind of give us an idea. A video can be a wonderful vehicle for you to kind of facilitate your students' learning. And there's just so many ways that you can use that. So I'm gonna go back to my slide to give you some ideas of what the common things that a lot of faculty use video for. The first thing first is that a lot of faculty use video to welcome students and onboard them. And some faculty actually use video for course syllabus overview. So they don't have to take out the classroom time to do that. They just have to mention about key points. And because it's recorded, it's nice after they watch a video, you give a syllabus quiz to make sure they really know what their what your expectations are for them to study this class. You can also use video for weekly overview. You kind of say, welcome to week one. We're going to do blah, blah, blah. So kind of give them the idea to open up the week. You can also wrap up, use a video, say, in this week, I'm so excited that we had a great discussion and what we're going to do next week. Kind of do a wrap up and start a new week. And then some faculty use video announcements because people don't read. So sometimes creator video could be also an enhancement to make sure they got the message, right? Sorry, let me go back to where I am. Okay, here we go. And then another thing is that a lot of the faculty use video to enhance teaching. For example, demonstration, lab, explaining a specific concept topic. You can also create ad hoc video to answer a question or the issue that people commonly, you know, miss. And you can also create some sort of video to give a reflective question to lead, you know, to guide their learning. So these are wonderful ways that faculty use video for. And I want to remind you, there's a link right here with a welcome and a link here is lab. You can click on these links to watch an example of actual UCF faculty's video to kind of get an idea how they make these videos. So don't forget to click on them to make sure that you kind of get an idea about how to do that. So that's what I would like to finish my part of the talk. And sorry, I go a little bit over time, but that's okay. I want to share with you some wonderful reading. They are so short, easy read. So this is actually a website to give you some tips about how to make your educational video more effective. It's from Vanderbilt University. And then this link is tell you 5-step guide to make your own instructional videos. This is what makes an online instructional video compelling. And this one is actually a research paper, designing and developing video lessons for online learning, a 7-principle model. So you may want to read that. It's really good. Another thing, everybody always asks me that question. The Quality Matters did a research to find out what would be a good video lens for online courses. And finally, we have this video sample provided by Professor Karna Wong at School of Social Sciences and how she used video to provide hint for their students learning. So this is all I have for the prep work for us to kind of prepare our mindset. I want to pause for a second and see if anybody has any questions. All right, if not, you know, our next presenter is our video producer, Natalie. She's gonna give you some tips about how to decide whether you want to repurpose the video that you recorded or you want to re-record the video. So I'm going to stop sharing and Natalie, feel free to start your presentation.
Thank you so much, Megan. I am so excited for today's workshop. I see a lot of familiar faces and a lot of new faces. So that's very exciting. And I loved how much experience there is, how everyone is kind of all over the board and what they want to do, what they've done in the past. So these are going to be really, really fun workshops. I've been producing instructional videos for UCI for over 10 years. Instructional video was really useful long before the pandemic, and it's going to be really useful long after the pandemic. When I first started out, I was recording lectures in the classroom. I'd be in the back of a classroom with a couple of cameras. And as some people said, being able to provide those video lectures for students who maybe missed class or even providing them for students to study with really yielded great results. And even when I was in class, I was one of those students where the professor would be talking too fast and I wouldn't be able to keep notes quick enough. And if I had been able to go back and review, would have been so helpful. But we are here to talk about repurposing or re-recording your videos. For the most part, a lot of people, as shown by our polls, have recorded a lot of videos over the past year, and those can still be useful. You can repurpose those, you can reuse them. I don't want you to think that, oh, when we go back to campus, everything you've done this year goes in the trash, because no, these videos are useful to provide and to reuse, but you might want to consider, do you want to reuse the videos you've already recorded, maybe clean them up, maybe make them a little more presentable for the future? Or there might be situations where it'll be easier and faster to re-record certain lectures or certain materials. So that's what we're going to talk about today, is kind of how you decide whether you want to repurpose or re-record your lectures. Next, or this coming Thursday, I'm going to be talking about tips, tricks, and best practices for recording new videos. So if you do want to record new videos, then please come to Thursday. And then next week are going to be our two Adobe Premiere Rush editing workshops, which are going to be a lot of fun. I've been hoping to do these for a while. So then everyone, whether you're repurposing videos or recording new videos, should either come to next week's workshops or register so you can get the video link afterwards. So, considerations. Should you repurpose your existing videos or record new ones? And the biggest is your time consideration, because editing videos can take a lot of time depending on how much you need to do. So that is the consideration you'll need to make. Do you just need to clean them up a little bit, maybe take off some information that'll date them to last year or to a previous year? Or is it just maybe you need to cover up some information that you don't want your next class to see, or maybe, you know, something changed in the content, you just need to take a little bit out? Those are very easy edits. So in that case, if you just need to do a little bit of cleanup, then it'll take you a lot less time to edit your existing videos. However, if you maybe taught a lot of live synchronous courses, then they might require more editing. For example, if you had a lot of back and forth with students, of course you want to protect students' privacy. So if your classes had big conversational chunks in them where your students were on camera and your students were identifying themselves, and you'd have to go and cut their information out of the lecture to present it to the next class, that might end up taking more time than just getting your slides and recording short lecture videos that you can provide and just spending a couple of weeks doing that. So it may be less time consuming in the long run to re-record your lectures, depending on how much cleanup you need to do. You might also want to consider the audio quality of your videos. And we've all learned a lot about video quality and audio quality just sitting in Zoom meetings all day for the past year. So if there are cleanup techniques you can use in editing software to clean up your audio, if maybe it's just a little low, you can always use an editing software to raise those levels. But if it's really difficult to hear, if maybe you were on an old laptop or you didn't have a nice microphone, then there might not be too much you can do with that audio cleanup. So I would recommend, if you're curious about the quality of your lectures, send them to a colleague, send a lecture to someone who hasn't seen the lecture before, wasn't in your class, and ask them, you know, can they understand it? Can they hear it clearly? Because another thing to remember is the better your audio quality, the more accurate your automatic captions are going to be, which is also a very important part of video production. So it might be that if you know, the audio quality isn't great and you're gonna have to go in and clean up those captions on Usia or clean up those captions on Zoom, maybe then you just wanna invest a little bit of money in a nice podcast microphone and re-record some of those lectures. And I've put some links at the bottom of this slide. One is to a little audio cheat sheet I developed at the beginning of the year to help you maybe think about how to get the best audio quality when you're recording. And the second link is a $30 USB podcast mic that has been the microphone we've been recommending for the past year. Everyone I've recommended this microphone to has had really great results, all levels of video production. Everyone really likes it. So you can get really great audio quality for very little money. So if that is something you are really worried about, you might want to get a new microphone. And of course, you know, please do your own research too. If there's a microphone you have your eye on or you want to learn a little more about, but having a microphone instead of just using an internal computer mic can really make a difference when you're producing these. And again, the better quality you can make your lectures, the longer you can use them. So really putting in the time upfront now can really elongate the shelf life, and you can be using these, you know, 5 years down the line. And so now you want to think about, okay, I have all these lectures. I recorded hours and hours of content over the past year. What can I do to them? What can I edit them? And the most common editing is trimming the beginnings, endings, and middles of your video. So again, maybe you were talking to your class in the beginning of your video, and that's not really going to be necessary to reuse. Or maybe, you know, there's some dead space at the end when you've stopped recording, or when you're ready to stop recording, you've closed your materials, you're going down there. Even making these little trims and getting rid of the dead space or unnecessary material at the beginning and end can really add that little bit of extra production quality to your videos. And you might also want to end out portions of the middle of your video. This means when you're recording, especially if you go and decide to record more videos, you don't need to be a one-take wonder. I always talk about using editing to make things easier in the actual recording process of your videos. That way, maybe you've got like 10 slides you need to present. You're great until slide 5, and then you fumble, you mess up, or you lose your place. You don't have to go back and start re-recording that lecture from scratch. Just stop, take a pause, start again, and know you can go and just in less than a minute, cut out that little flub from your video in editing. So that'll make your production time so much smoother. And maybe you recorded a lecture and there's an area where you started kind of talking about something else, or you started going off script a little bit and you like that video, but you don't want to use that portion. You can just clip that out, save it as a new video, and you don't have to re-record the entire thing. That's a way you can repurpose your videos. You can also edit a long lecture into smaller chunks. And Megan mentioned earlier that we have a link about how long should a lecture video be. And the answer is not 50 minutes. We recommend more like 10 minutes, but maybe you were doing these synchronous Zoom sessions where you're talking to your students for 50 minutes. If you can identify nice edit points, like maybe you change topics after 7 minutes, or maybe then you did an activity you don't need, that you don't want to include in your video, you can figure out ways to take that long 50-minute video file and chunk it up into smaller little lecture pieces that you can provide your students. And this also makes it a little less burdensome on your students as well, because if they see a 50-minute video file, they're not necessarily going to want to sit and watch 50 minutes. Maybe they'll watch a few minutes, maybe then they'll close their laptop, they forgot where they were, but they're more likely to watch more video content if they have a lot of small lectures than just a few really long, daunting lectures. And even when I've taken online classes, it's almost kind of fun when you have a lot of little lectures, because I'll think, I'm kind of tired, I don't have half an hour, but oh, a 10-minute video, I can watch that. I can watch that and take notes. Oh, the next one's only 5 minutes? Yeah, I'll do that one too. And it actually will help your students get through more video content than just two really, really long lectures a week. And as I mentioned, you are going to want to edit out students from synchronous recordings. And this is, again, where if your lectures were highly, highly interactive, it may make more sense to just re-record them. However, if it was just maybe a student chimed in really quickly and asked a question, or a student had unmuted their microphone and didn't realize it and speaker view went to them, you might just want to cut them out of the video to protect their privacy. And you can also easily, if it was just the speaker view and your student appears up in the corner of your video, you can hide them in editing. You can just either go full screen on a slide, or you can just put a little like color mat over them just to cover up the little video section so that they don't appear in your lectures when you go on to teach another class. As I said, also editing out information such as the date or the quarter from certain slides, or if you mention, you know, in Thursday's discussion section, but now you're not teaching discussions on Thursdays, just cutting out those little words to make it so your students don't immediately recognize, oh, this is an old video. This is from someone else's class. What, I'm watching someone else's videos. These aren't new and specifically for me. But you can just edit out this little bit of information, and that also will, again, make your lectures usable quarter after quarter after quarter, because now your students are just watching a lecture that, you know, has the title or the topic of what you're talking about. It doesn't say June 27th, 2019, and now they're doing the math and going, how long ago was this recorded? Is this information still good? Is this still current? And that can just be either covering up your video with a new slide where you've deleted that information, or just cutting out the little itty bitty segments where you might mention the date. And these are all very, very easy things to do. Of course, if you're listening to all these different things I'm talking about and you're going, oh my gosh, I made mistakes in the beginning of my video, then I had all of this student information, and I know that I mentioned the date like 5 times. And if it seems overwhelming, then maybe you will just want to re-record. But these are all considerations that you'll need to make, or join me in my breakout room at the end of today's workshop, and we'll talk about it and figure out what the best solution for you is. And lastly, combining videos is a really popular action. So this may mean taking a clip you produced and then maybe, a fair use clip that you got that you want to talk about and turning them into one video file. Or maybe you've got little clips from multiple lectures, like you talked about this topic in this lecture and in this lecture, and you just want to put them together in a single little video that you can share about that topic. It's really easy to do this in video editing. And I have had some instructors try to do this in the Usia video editor. It is possible in the Usia video editor, but it is a major headache. So if you do think you're going to want to, take a few little video pieces and put them into one, then please come to my workshops next weekend on Adobe Premiere Rush, and you'll see that this can be done in less than 2 minutes. It is really, really quick. And that's one of the things I really want to help everyone do, is make sure you can make really great videos without taking up too much of your time, because I know everyone's always extremely busy. And that's the number one concern, is how much time is this going to take me? Do I have time to do all of this? And hopefully my job is to help you figure out how to do this in the least amount of time possible. And then you get to save all that time in the future when you already have these videos that you can keep putting into your courses. So lastly, I just want to talk about preparing your tools and materials for video editing. So let's say you've gotten this far, you've listened, you've said, you know what, I've got a lot of lecture content, a lot of videos I made last year, and I do want to reuse them. I do want to just repurpose. I think it's going to be easy. What kind of prep work should I do? So you'll want to update any necessary slides. As I mentioned, if we need to remove certain information, you can go into your old slide deck, just take out dates, take out certain titles, and then save that particular slide as an image file. So like a JPEG or a PNG, it's really easy in PowerPoint or Google Slides to save just a single slide as an image file. And that image file is what you will need when you go into your video editor. Most video editors can't take straight PowerPoint presentations, so you will need to turn those into images. And I am very happy to show anyone how to do that if they don't already know. Maybe you want to record new pieces to add to your existing videos. So maybe in a class you solved a certain problem, like an engineering problem, a mathematical problem, something that you want to say, hey, this might be really helpful for students to study with. I want to give them this clip, but I didn't really set it up in the long lecture. We had already talked about it. Maybe you want to record just a short little talking head intro telling them, in the following clip, we're going to solve this kind of problem. This is what I wanted you to take away from it. Just a little supplement to put on the front of that video clip to help kind of guide your students to what you want them to take away from it. And so you can easily do that in Zoom. Just make sure you've got all your pieces ready, go in, record your intros, or maybe you even want to just record a little outro at the end in case you want your students to see your face and you just did pure full screen slide presentations. You can just record yourself, saying goodbye and wishing them the best and that you'll see them next week. Just something little to tack on to the end of a video. You're also going to want to know how to organize all of these files. And this might be the most important tip I can give, because if you've recorded a lot of videos, if you're going to be editing a lot of videos, really quickly, you're going to have a lot of video files and it will be really easy to forget which file is which and what is where. So if you've downloaded a video off of Zoom before, you'll notice that the title it gives you is a string of numbers and letters. It doesn't tell you in the title what the class was or what the date was. It just gives you this long kind of string. And if you keep downloading videos really quickly, you're not going to be able to remember what's what lecture, what's what I recorded when. So I recommend setting up a folder system. If you're working with a specific course in mind, then have a folder with the name of that course, and within there have two folders. One folder where you're going to store your raw downloaded videos, and one folder where you're going to put your finished edited videos. So that way, when it comes time to upload videos to Usia or to your course page, you have a folder that's just those final edited videos. And then when you download a video, rename it based on what it is. So if it's Psych 9B Lecture 1, rename that video file so later if you need to find it, you're not having to click through and watch a little bit of every video to figure out what is what. Then once you've taken that video, You've put it into your editing software, you've cleaned it up, and now it's time to save it as a new video file. I'll usually save that as the same title, so Psych 9B Lecture 2, whatever I had just said it was, and then add either edited or new at the end so I can identify that's the new video. And I want to make sure that's the one in my edited videos folder. So when it comes time to upload, I'm only uploading those videos and I know what everything is. And the last thing you'll want to do is have your video editing software. Now, if you've already edited with a software, which a lot of people have, and you have a software you like and that works for you, then keep using that. The best solution is the solution you're most comfortable with. However, if you haven't edited before, or maybe you're not as happy with the video editor you've tried to use, I recommend Adobe Premiere Rush, because this software works on both Mac and Windows computers and is free to all faculty, staff, and students from OIT. So you can sign up for an Adobe Creative Cloud license from OIT that will be good at least through the end of June 2022. So how do you download Adobe Premiere Rush? You're going to go to oit.uci.edu/Adobe. And if I can have Megan or Fanny, can you please put this link in the chat? And it'll take you to the download page. You'll see there are two buttons for faculty, staff, and guests, and for students. You'll click the for faculty, staff, and guests button, and that will lead you to follow the steps to obtain a license. I really recommend following the instructions on OIT's instruction page for downloading Adobe, just to make sure you're logging in through the UCI credentials so that you have full access. It's really easy to accidentally register as a personal account, and then it'll say you only have a 7-day trial. Don't worry if that happens. Just follow the instructions on OIT's page to make sure you have the UCI license through July 2022. The good news is then you have access to tons of Adobe Creative Cloud apps. So beyond Rush, you'll have access to Photoshop and After Effects and InDesign and so much more. So if you enjoy this kind of creative work, it is going to be such a game changer to have access to all of these programs. And I will mention that this is for faculty, staff, and students who are not part of health sciences, but you can still get Adobe if you are a part of the health sciences. They have their own agreement. You just need to submit a ticket with them and they can get you set up under their licensing account. I know I just went really quickly through a lot of information. I'm going to stop sharing my screen before we turn it over. And does anyone have any really quick questions? All right, if not, then I'm going to turn it over to Megan to introduce our guest speaker for today.
Thank you, Natalie. That is awesome. Again, these workshops are it's just 1 hour. So we are trying to use the time to get together to help us to really think about design and specific technical stuff, we will cover in next week's workshop. So next week, if you join us on Thursday and Monday, we're going to talk about Adobe Premiere Rush, and then you can learn about hands-on how to edit that. So hopefully you get a very nice taste about repurposing your videos. So today it is our honor to have Sabrina join us and share about her experience, how to produce overview video to walk through the student about the content. So I'm going to stop share again. And Sabrina, whenever you're ready, feel free to unmute your microphone and share your screen if you have something to share. Thank you so much, Sabrina.
Great, thank you. So thank you for inviting me to talk about overview videos, or what I call walkthrough videos. So I'm just gonna mention very quickly why I create these videos and what they're all about. And then I'll show you one of my walkthrough videos. And then when I'm finished, I'll just talk a little bit about the process. So, and I'll show you the walkthrough video and then talk a little bit about the process. I do want to start by saying I am a very much an amateur in the video production space. I might even consider myself an amateur just with technology in general. I rarely use my phone. I never take photos. I don't take videos. So the reason why I wanted to create these videos is because when I decided to start teaching in the School of Education, that was fall of 2020, you know, we were online, and I was talking to a colleague of mine and, you know, just sharing my concerns about how students will know what's happening in my course. I had never taught online. And so my a friend of mine, Doran Zinger, he's actually the director of the CalTeach program at UCI. He said, well, you know, I really like these overview videos. And so he showed me his overview video, which he created using Yuja. I said, oh, that's so great. And so he kind of just I was just so amazed that he could like show his face and the slides on the same screen. And I thought, that's so cool. And I wanted to do that. And so I thought, I want to do this overview video. Now, my, like I said, I call them walkthrough videos, has taken kind of a different shape because it's not just an overview of what's happening during the upcoming week, but I also do a very quick check-in. And then you'll see in the video, I also talk about what's coming up in the following week. And then I always end with a moment of reflection. And so, like I said, so it's taken a different shape, and I really owe the Digital Learning Institute and Fanny for helping me create, and Natalie, of course, for helping me create a much better version of the original walkthrough that was created using Yuja. And it's still not at that place I hope it will be, but you know, we have more quarters ahead of us. And I also want to mention that my other motivation, so I really was concerned about how students would know what was happening in my class. And then also I was very concerned about the lack of just student faculty interactions now that, you know, we were going online, and I really wanted to find ways to humanize my course. And so I thought, like, if I spent a good, you know, 8 minutes with my students in this video format, just talking about the course, sometimes I even talk about what I'm up to when I end the video, that it would make the course, that it would help humanize the course. So let me share my screen and then I'll play the video. So I think you should be able to see my screen. Is that right?
Yes. And you can make the browser as a full screen, so the video will be a lot bigger.
Make it full screen. There we go. Okay. So here's my Canvas page. And on every Canvas page, every week I have an overview video, and it's the first thing that I'm hoping my students watch before they get into the material. I don't know if that's happening or not.
Hi class, and welcome to the week 8 walkthrough video. Similar to prior weeks, I'll spend some time catching up. And then we'll take a look at week 8 in more detail. And then I'll wrap up by looking ahead to week 9. Let's get started. Catching up. What did we do last week? Last week was a pretty light week in terms of course material. We started our unit on teachers. I assigned a video on teacher wars, which provided a pretty in-depth history of teaching. You also submitted quiz number 3, which means there are only 2 more to go. And I met with SMU groups 5 through 8 for our third session together. We had an engaging conversation around school choice policy, and it was really interesting to see where all of you stand. Similar to what I mentioned last week, I think that most of us consider the policy to be interesting and one that could work in theory, but we have some reservations about the way it actually plays out in practice. And then you also submitted a short survey on mini project number 1. Now let's take a look at week 8 in more detail. You see here that week 8 is another relatively light week. You have your reflective writing assignment number 4 due, and then I meet with SMU groups 1 through 4 for our fourth and final SMU session together. I can't believe it. We'll talk about the unit on teachers and teacher policy. So here's the week 8 course page, and you'll see that I've included information for week 7, right? The Teacher Wars video. And I'm also going to have you listen to something which I'm calling Professor's Thoughts. And this was inspired by feedback that one of you gave me on the last quiz. One of you asked about note-taking strategies and ways to study better for the quizzes using the course material and specifically the reading. So what I'm going to do is provide you with an annotated version of one of the readings, annotated by me. And then I was thinking of just kind of sitting down and recording my thoughts on the reading and what I would pay more attention to. And I'm going to do this in lieu of a lecture series. We'll see how it goes. There are 6 relatively short articles, and this unit focuses, or I should say, the second half of this unit focuses on the teacher labor market. So what I mean by that is teacher recruitment policies, teacher retention policies, and a close look at teacher salaries and how those salaries have changed over time. Okay, you have a reflection due on the 20th, and as we just saw, quiz number 4 due on the 25th. This reflection is available now. So let's take a look at it. Reflection number 4 is asking that you focus on the article about diversifying the teacher workforce, Figlio 2017 and the supplementary visuals. So let me show you what I mean by that. That's reading number 3. This Brookings paper, The Importance of a Diverse Teaching Force. And number 4 is the supplemental materials that go with that. So reflection number 4 revolves around reading 3 and 4. Okay. So I'm asking that you respond to all 3 prompts in your response. Prompt 1, what are some of the challenges to diversifying the teaching workforce? What are some of the benefits of having a diverse teaching workforce? And lastly, what are some ways to recruit more K-12 teachers of color? Please pull from that Figlio 2017 and supplementary visual material. Okay? But you can also weave in other readings. I note that here. In responding, feel free to weave in other readings that are relevant and or your own history, personal experience with this topic, in addition to course material from week 7 to 8. So it looks like I will post a video about mini project number 2 around the week 8 time, probably sooner though. And then lastly, I meet with SMU groups 5 through 8 for our session where we'll talk about teacher policy.
So now let's look ahead to week 9. Week 9 starts on May 24th. We're going to start talking about different policies to educate diverse learners. You have a quiz due on the 25th, which is a Tuesday. And that's quiz number 4, which revolves around course material from week 7 and 8. I'll meet with SMU groups 5 through 8 for our final SMU session together. We'll talk about the unit on teachers. And that wraps up week number 9. So now let's stop and think. Pause. Think about this course and the course material and the assignments. We're heading into the final couple weeks of the quarter, and I really ask that you think about ways to finish the quarter successfully. And then ask yourself if you need to reach out to me so that I can better support you as we progress through these final weeks. I mentioned on day 1 that I consider myself a partner in your learning.
and I really do. So email me if you have any questions or concerns, or visit me during office hours. I think each and every one of you has worked very hard this quarter, and I want to see you all do your best and finish strong. Thanks for watching. See you next time. Okay, so did it play?
Okay. Yes, it's awesome.
See, I still don't even know. So that video, so like I said, it's literally the same every week, except, I mean, the content is different, but the format is the same. And so just to quickly wrap up and tell you about the process, as I said, you know, I'm very much an amateur. So when I first recorded using Zoom, let me see my notes here. Yep, I recorded using Zoom, and then I used iMovie to edit. And so when I, for the first time, I just, you know, it took me forever. So it took 2 hours to produce that little 10-minute, it's between 7 to 10 minutes, and I found the shortest one to show today, which was 7 minutes. But it took 2 hours because I wasn't familiar with iMovie, editing, all of that stuff. And then I met with Natalie, and she really helped me understand how to use iMovie. And then from that point forward, it was much easier. So, you know, I just basically would copy the walkthrough video, and then I would create a copy, and then I would just like delete, you know, content and insert new content, but at least all the frames were there. And so by the end of the quarter, it would only take 20 minutes to make, 25 minutes, depending on like how. Sometimes I would think to myself, oh, with editing, I will just kind of talk and edit out what I don't want to include. But that really wasn't a good idea because it would take so long. So then I changed my thought process and said, like, no, I'm going to try to do this video so that it needs no editing whatsoever. And so, like I said, eventually it was just like 20 to 25 minutes. And lastly, oh yeah. And in the beginning, I was so neurotic. I wanted to rewatch the video and make it seem like seamless. It never was. So then by the end of the quarter, I just told myself, who knows? No one may even be watching this thing. So why are you spending, you know, all this time? But then students did mention, you know, in the evals, and I always hold like this little focus group with students at the end of the quarter. They said that it was helpful. So I continued to do it. Lastly, I did have some issues. I always seem to have delayed audio. It must be my internet. And then I think that was the main issue. It was the delayed audio. But other than that, Zoom plus iMovie was way better than Yuja. Yeah. And that was it. I don't think I have anything else.
Thank you so much. That was awesome. So thank you very much, Sabrina, for sharing your wonderful video with us. I was just gonna finish up my test here. I actually think that students love these kind of not perfect video much better. They engage with you much because it's more real. It's like you're a real person versus like you're the news broadcaster, like try to do this professional. Those kind of video tend to be more like a CD-ROM video that kind of disconnect. So I love faculty record a video with your personal characters in there. That is just a great example. So I want to go back to the PowerPoint that I have here. So let me share my screen again. But I do want to thank you for coming here to today's session. And if you want to get more help on editing your videos or create your video, you can actually create a one-on-one appointment with Natalie.